Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Bismillah,
wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. I wanted to take this opportunity to record a small reminder for myself, for you, and obviously all of our audience, inshallah ta'ala, about a serious matter. You know, given the recent events and tragedies that are taking place in Gaza, that are piling on top of all of the other tragedies that the Ummah is facing, everywhere from Burma to Syria to Iraq to Afghanistan and Bangladesh and so on and so forth. You know, it's easy to get frustrated and overwhelmed with everything that's happening, and people are asking what can the average Muslim do to respond to this, especially in the month of Ramadan. Maybe, you know, people ask what kind of special dua I can make, and actually some people at the campus also asked me, are there any particular duas we can make for our brothers and sisters that are in oppression? And I've been racking my brain thinking what duas are there for the oppressed in particular, and I couldn't think of really anything in specific, so I wanted to run that same question by you too.
So, bismillah, alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. I mean, honestly, this is something that really, it hits home. And number one, I think we should remind everyone that, you know, before Palestine, there was much more, there was a lot going on as well. And subhanAllah, sometimes, naturally, there are certain things that stir us a little bit more.
Yeah.
Obviously, Palestine with the land of Al-Aqsa, the third of the Harams, and the first Qibla of the Muslims. And it's unbelievable, subhanAllah, it's interesting. And I think that there's a hidden benefit in this, that there is no cause that unites the hearts of the Muslims like Palestine. Mm. There's no cause that just unanimously, everyone in the Muslim world is tuned in when Palestine comes under attack.
Yeah.
And the hearts of the people, you know, whether it was the Algerian World Cup, you know, salaries being donated towards Gaza and things of that sort. I mean, just everyone's heart naturally feels a special attachment to Palestine. And I think first and foremost, we have to, you know, one of the things that I always tell people is acquaint yourself with the conflicts that are not your own, in the sense that,
that's right,
you know, the Palestinians should be making dua for the Burmese. The Burmese should be making dua for the people in the Central African Republic. You know, they should be making dua for the people in Syria. Giving money to people that don't necessarily belong to your cause, that you don't have any tie to, except for your, you know, the fact that
just to reignite a sense of ummah.
Absolutely, to reignite that sense of ummah. And I think that's really crucial. As far as the du'as are concerned, you know, the best du'a is the one from the heart in your own language.
Yeah.
We were having this conversation that, you know, you don't find a precedence for this in the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, because the ummah was all together.
Yep. And we were in a position of power, really.
We were in a position of power, absolutely. Yeah. And so the du'as that were made, you do find sometimes where the Prophet ﷺ made du'a against the oppressors, in his qunut in particular.
Yeah.
And that's one thing that I'd recommend to people. The qunut is not just to be done in witr, in times of oppression. Actually, the Prophet ﷺ did it in every salah.
Really?
Yes. So it's Fajr through Isha. You can also add the Qunut at the end and make dua for your brothers and sisters in the last rak'ah, before or after your bowing, before or after your ruku'. It's a sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do so in times of tribulation.
Hmm.
Now, as far, again, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was no segment of the ummah that was being oppressed. So make the dua that's really heartfelt. Try to shed a tear and have full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's one of the main things that...
The thought I had that I'd like to add here is that I think, you know, because we have online presence and we make comments every once in a while, or a video gets posted and things like that, the real spirit of dua is actually very personal. And like I can remind you and you can remind me that we should be making dua.
And you can write Ameen on the comments, but that means
but
nothing.
That right? doesn't really mean anything. Yeah. Like, real dua is going to be when you and I are in our private moments and we're not publicizing that we're making dua, that we're actually connecting this word with Allah Azza wa Jalla. It's not for show to somebody else that I made dua for this or that or the other, but rather it's between us and Allah Azza wa Jalla. And that's from the public figures down to the person who's not in the public eye. Every one of us just has to reconnect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the month to make dua for ourselves, for our families, and for the ummah at large, which is in a sense our family, you know.
And if you're spending more time writing online about the conflict than talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about and complaining to Allah, that really shows a lack of priorities there.
Yeah, yeah. And a lack of understanding of what has an impact on reality. Us blowing hot air about our anger and our esteem. Yes, the conversation should never die, in my opinion, either. I think we should make noise about it, and we should, you know, there should be some conversation about the human rights violations in particular that are happening. Obviously, there are sometimes that are the political situations are so complicated that looking at it from the outside, you don't really truly know what's going on. But the one thing you do know for sure is blood is being spilled. Muslims are being killed. Innocent people are being killed. You know, that's the bottom line is oppression is happening. And that's something we can all speak out against and, you know, stand up against. But the other issue is that we have to really learn to make private, sincere dua to Allah and recognize that that's actually an agent of change. Like, a lot of times in my personal conversation with some people, when you talk about making dua, like, oh, that's all? Is that it? You just want us to make dua?
And that's that misunderstanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could very well be why victory doesn't come. Mm. You know, there's a story, subhanAllah, when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he saw that the people were, you know, Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu obviously became an icon in the ummah.
Right.
And people were even coming up to him and saying, you know, did your sword actually come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Did it come from the heavens? It became like that. He became such an icon.
Yeah.
And Umar radiallahu anhu, he saw that. And when he saw that, you know, he did something that was very controversial. And there are a lot of like...
removing him from position.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. There are a lot of these false narrations that, you know, it was because of a personal grudge that they had back in the day. And absolutely not. He said...
That's all speculation.
Yeah. Really. He said that I did it not because... Well, he said, وَاللَّهِ مَا عَزَّتُ خَالِدٍ عَنْ سَخْطَةٍ وَلَا خِيَانَةٍ. I didn't remove him because of any issues. I had no personal issues. وَلَكِنِّي خَشِيتُ أَنْ يُفْتَنَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ بِهِ. I was afraid that the Muslims would be tried by Khalid. فَيُوكِلُونَ إِلَيْهِ. So they would be entrusted to Khalid radiallahu anhu. Look at the last part of that. They would be entrusted to Khalid. Allah would leave them to Khalid because they think that victory comes from Khalid radiallahu
anhu. So just leave the matter to Khalid himself.
Absolutely. So yeah. He switched him to Abu Ubaidah al-Jarrah. And guess what was opened under Abu Ubaidah al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu? Jerusalem. Hmm. Al-Quds.
SubhanAllah.
So we can't discount dua. You know, we cannot, we have to recognize that victory comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yeah.
And it could very well be that your personal dua with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in private could be the change that you know that comes to the Muslim world.
Like, a final comment that I wanted to make is that, you know, when it comes to dua and ibadah to Allah Azza wa Jal, it is actually one of the most powerful indiscriminate forces that Allah has given us. In other words, you know, a lot of people know us and there's somebody sitting in a masjid somewhere making dua and nobody knows him. We don't know how much more powerful their dua is.
Absolutely.
Like, you know, your dua isn't any less valuable than mine or somebody else's, or ours isn't more valuable than somebody else's. That is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal.
You know, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu actually says that one time when there was no rain, everyone was doing Salat al-Istisqa, asking for rain. And he said, I found a slave that was making a dua privately. And he said, Allahumma inni as'aluka bihubbika ilayya. Oh Allah, I ask you by your love for me to send rain down. And as soon as he made that dua, the rain came down.
SubhanAllah.
Many, many narrations of that sort where the imams, the sahaba, the tabi'een were making dua and the rain wasn't coming. But it was that private servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that called upon Allah azza wa jalla and was truly beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
I just think of the fact that Allah has blessed us with, you know, healthy families, children, and the people that we're making dua for that are so far away and we barely even see any news about them, but we hear about the kinds of horrible things they go through. We're not any more deserving of the peace and tranquility and happiness that we enjoy in this world, and they're not any more deserving of the kinds of things that they're going through, and this is by the qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal. So just seeing the calm state of affairs that our families enjoy should actually remind us of how much more dua we should be making for those who haven't been given those things, and they're being tested by difficulty as much as we're being tested by ease. You know, and they must be a lot stronger people than we are, because Allah only gives people what they can handle. So these are amazing people. May Allah make them strong and may Allah help them get through this and reward them immensely for the kinds of troubles they're going through. I pray that, you know, all of us, inshallah, engage in more sincere dua for the oppressed and, inshallah, do whatever we can to help in, you know, genuine humanitarian causes that can actually do good and help these people in whatever circumstance that they're going through. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thanks for stopping by. Take care, inshallah.